Welcome everybody to Pediatric Grand Rounds. Today is one of our special Grand Rounds, which is the annual Tooley Symposium. And I'd like to turn it over to our chief of the Division of Neonatology, Dr. Yao Sun, to give us a little bit of the history of how this symposium was established. Dr. Sun.
Thank you, Dr. Hirsch. It's really my pleasure to give a little context to this lecture and the visiting professorship. Dr. William Tooley, or Bill Tooley, was the founding division chief of the Division of Neonatology here at UCSF. He was literally a giant of a man. He stood around 6'8" or so, but was also a giant figuratively in terms of his scientific and clinical innovations. Among the advances that he instituted and fostered were actually active intervention to treat premature and sick term infants at a time when kind of passive observation of sick babies was the norm. Careful physiological monitoring. So he brought laboratory instruments such as GRAS monitors, which some of you may know from your laboratory work, into the intensive care unit to actually use on babies. The increased role of nurses as collaborators in a collegial and non-hierarchical environment, also establishing a close and cooperative relationship with the obstetricians. So he set up our setup room right now, which is adjacent to the operating rooms in delivery in the delivery suite, was an idea that he founded to make the transition from maternal to neonatal care as seamless as possible. He also established the ICN follow-up clinic and establishing a model for following the development of the babies that he cared for in the nursery. That is a model that's used across the United States. And so with that context, I'd like to go ahead and allow one of our pediatric surgery colleagues, Dr. Amar Nijigal, to introduce our visiting professor for the year, Dr. Stephen Fishman.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sun and Dr. Hirsch. It's my distinct pleasure to introduce Dr. Steve Fishman as this year's visiting professor for the William H. Tooley Memorial Lecture. Dr. Fishman is a Chicago native and completed his undergraduate and medical education at Northwestern University. He was then destined for the East Coast, completing his surgical residency at the University of Pennsylvania, followed by a pediatric surgical fellowship at Boston Children's Hospital, where he has since stayed as faculty. He is currently a professor of surgery at Harvard Medical School and the chief of surgery and surgeon in chief at Boston Children's Hospital. Dr. Fishman has made seminal contributions in the area of lymphovascular anomalies and is an internationally recognized expert in the field. I won't recount his CV today, but did want to share some personal reflections about Dr. Fishman, as I have a unique vantage point as he trained me as his surgical fellow. In short, Dr. Fishman is a remarkable human being. What always struck me as his fellow was his dedication to our education and his enthusiasm to support and encourage our careers. He's always generous with his time and is an active listener in conversation, likely all made possible by his passion for organization and efficiency, which I share. This was made all too clear when he and I were discussing the nuances of the organizational software Evernote. And my jaw literally dropped when he told me that he has two notebooks in Evernote. One is entitled Now and the other Later. This system has obviously served him well in his career. Dr. Fishman, thank you so much for sharing your time with us, and we look forward to your presentation.
Well, I want to, Amar, thank you. I want to thank Yao Sun, a longtime friend. We trained together at Boston Children's. I want to thank Dr. Hirsch. I want to thank Haman Lee. I want to thank all of you for the opportunity to speak at this special symposium in honor of Dr. Tooley. I am not a neonatologist and can't pretend to be one. So it is quite an honor as a surgeon to be invited to speak to you. I certainly have enjoyed meeting with many of your faculty of making rounds virtually in your NICU. I particularly enjoyed meeting with some of the neonatology fellows yesterday and have enjoyed the talks this morning and look forward to the talks this afternoon. I must say, I've done a lot of these types of visitations, and I'm always honored to do so. And I'm usually pretty comfortable speaking about vascular anomalies, which is really the only thing I know anything about. But speaking at your institution is a little bit intimidating. It's like bringing coals to Newcastle. For those of you who are able to see Dr. Lona Frieden's keynote speech this morning, you can see that you have the world's expertise at your fingertips. And so I hope I can impart a little bit of wisdom. I hope you all know that you have a world-class team in your halls from across all disciplines. Lona Frieden truly is a giant in the field, and I owe a lot to her, as does the field. I will try and share my screen here. Hopefully, by this point in the pandemic, I know how to do this. Is that showing presenter view?
Yes.
Terrific. I'm not, as Amar and Haman and Yao know, I'm not a really formal guy. So if there are questions in the middle, I don't mind somebody popping up and interrupting. I know it's in seminar view, but please feel free to pop in if somebody's got something urgent to ask here. So I'm gonna talk about over time, as I'm aging, the perspectives that I think we've gained by really paying attention to our patients. You know, one of my great mentors, Judah Folkman, the father of angiogenesis and angiogenesis inhibition, he always said, I have many Folkmanisms, but one of the things he said is, cherish your exceptions. That's where you can learn. And so I'm gonna talk a little bit about some things that we've learned, not just myself, but my team in Boston Children's and the larger community of vascular anomalists around the world, those in San Francisco included. A few disclosures. I'm going to go really fast. I'm just telling stories, as the neonatology fellows commented me yesterday. I'm a storyteller, and I am. And my slides are almost exclusively photos. It wasn't until I was in my 40s that I realized why my talks are all pictures. It's because, in part because I found that I'm dyslexic, and it's really hard for me to read and talk at the same time. I'm going to show things that I'm going to describe myself, but really almost everything is a credit to others with whom I've been blessed to collaborate or learn from. I will reference some medications that are not specifically necessarily approved these uses. The most important disclosure is I am not a scientist. And so I will be referring to some science, but if you ask me too many detailed questions about them, I may duck them. So you all know, as neonatologists, that hemangioma is the most common tumor of infancy. About 4% of Caucasian babies will have a hemangioma. This is fortunately a benign tumor, but sometimes they are quite devastating in their manifestations. If we could figure out nature's program for why these involute naturally, and this is an example of an untreated baby, you can see in just a couple of years, this thing has really dramatically involuted, left a little bit of loose skin that could easily be tucked up if the family so choose. But sometimes it doesn't work so well. And I'm gonna show you a more disturbing series. This is a baby who around the left eye here early on developed a little early stain, which within just months progressed on to devastation. Despite aggressive medical therapy at the time, this is in the preprenatal era, this child ended up with a no vision in the left eye and significant cosmetic deformity. In this day and age, this child would get preprenatal treatment immediately upon diagnosis, and hopefully would not have this. Ilona spoke this morning about the wonderful story of how propranolol was discovered to work for this decades after propranolol had been in use for cardiac indications. And again, it was a prepared mind and an observant clinician in France who made this observation. I'm not going to go into hemangiomas in general, but I'm going to talk about some observations we've made. Now, we've known that about 20% of babies who have hemangiomas will have multiple hemangiomas. And we've learned to think that if there are multiple lesions, to think about visceral lesions, and the most common visceral lesions are hepatic lesions. Now, I think it's important to pause at this point to mention that the dermatologic community, the pediatric dermatologic community, led by Lona Friedan in the country and the world, has made an important impact here, because they have taught themselves and their trainees and the rest of the community to think about the liver. The liver is not an organ that dermatologists usually think about. And so they routinely, when they see babies with five or more hemangiomas or so, and they've published this extensively, they recommend or perform screening ultrasonography, and they find hemangiomas in the liver routinely. That was not true 15 years ago. And that has gone on to change the course of lives for many children. So I'll go back to the liver in a second. One of the things that in the course of my career happened that we sort of noticed is this other kind of hemangioma. So hemangiomas generally, they're not there at birth, or maybe they're a little stain in about a third of babies, and then they proliferate over the next several weeks and months. But there's this rare subset, it turns out to be not so rare, where they're present at birth and they're fully grown at birth, and they involute really fast. So here's an example of this. You can see this in utero MRI of this head with a huge lesion on the side of it. And this was a family in Florida. The obstetrician sent us this image. And by this point, we had sort of figured out what these were. And we said, it's no problem. It's a benign tumor. It's called a rapidly involuting congenital hemangioma. And it's going to go away. And, you probably should do a C-section so it doesn't rupture, during vaginal delivery. But don't worry about it. And they did not feel comfortable delivering. And the family chose to come up to Boston. And we simply delivered the baby. And here's the delivery. And you can see at birth, this lesion is already significantly smaller than it was in utero. It was already involuting as the child was maturing in utero. And all we did was send the baby back to Florida and ask them to send some pictures. And here's the pictures over time. So this is very different than a typical hemangioma, which takes years to proliferate and then to involute. We gave it this name, we called it a riche. And you might look at the name and say, why is it a riche and not a rich? And this is just the way medical history happens. Around the same time that we had noticed this pattern, there's another group in Paris led by Odile Angelras, another very prominent dermatologist who we unfortunately have lost, who noticed this group, this as well. And she and her pathologist, Michelle Wassef, came over to Boston and sat down on the weekend down in the pathology lab and comparing pictures and comparing histology and sort of what's the difference between this and the standard infantile hemangioma and sort of described it. John Mulliken, sort of founder of the field as a plastic surgeon, likes to put sort of acronyms and everything. The pathologist, described it rapidly involuting congenital hemangioma. And Michel Wassef, who speaks very good English, but with a heavy Parisian accent, he said, ah, riche. And Harry Kazakiewicz, our Canadian-American pathologist, said, no, rich. And John Mulliken said, I think riche sounds better. And literally, that is, it is still called riche around the world, just because somebody thought it sounded better. So I'm going to get back to why that's important. When I started in this field as a general pediatric surgeon, I was drawn into it because people wanted somebody to think about the inside stuff. It was mostly a field led by dermatologists and plastic surgeons. And they said, we're skin doctors, but this stuff happens inside and somebody's got to figure this out. And I started thinking about hepatic hemangiomas and, they're not that rare and everybody had learned about them. And the classic teaching was that they have this triad of hepatomegaly, high output heart failure, and anemia. And of course, like most triads in medicine, not all the patients follow that. In fact, most of them don't follow this one. We thought they were all the same. And sometimes they were bad, and oftentimes they were bad. And everybody remembers their bad case. And so when I started in this field, the logic was there were lots of different options for treatment. You could give chemotherapy, you could surgically remove them, you could embolize the hepatic arteries, you could, you know, ligate the hepatic arteries. There was all sorts of options. You could give steroids. And best I could tell, and best the literature could show evidence for, is that when you had one and your last patient did well, whatever worked, you did that again. And if you had one that didn't do well, next time you pick something different. And that was about as much science as there was to the way these were managed. And we thought it there had to be a way to make more sense. And so we created a registry where we said we should look at a lot of these. And we went back and looked at our own that we had. And then we sort of offered up, and the internet was just getting started. And we said, all right, well, we will review any hemangioma in the liver for any patient around the world for free within 24 to 48 hours with an interdisciplinary approach with our pathologists and radiologists and all of our different views in exchange for, please let us know how the patient does or share the imaging going forward. And so we looked at these patterns, and I looked at this as a very simplistic surgeon and looked at the patterns, and along with Pat Burrows, our interventional radiologist, who was a guru at the time. And we thought that there was like three patterns. There was focal lesions, there was multifocal lesions, and there were diffuse lesions. And so here's an example of focal lesion. No matter what modality you look at, it looks like a tumor, like a ball in the liver. It'd be interesting to talk with you neonatologists to think about the rheology of the liver, because they all have this sort of central necrosis or what's really a clot. And I believe that happens because of the change from prenatal circulation to postnatal circulation, something that UCSF is historic for having described, Dr. Rudolph, et cetera. Here's a baby. It had a big liver lesion. And here's another picture 8 weeks later. And you don't need to be a radiologist to see the liver got a lot smaller. This is an untreated baby. This baby was in the hospital for other reasons. And we happened to be able to get an x-ray. So it turns out, we thought about this and we said, once we realized what this reach was, we realized, wait a minute, hemangiomas in the skin, they're not present at birth, or they're just sort of really minor stains at birth, and then they proliferate. And these hepatic focal lesions, they're there, we see them before birth. In fact, now we almost always see them before birth. And they go away, and they go away fast all by themselves, just like that lesion on the side of the head. So we looked histologically, we proved, sure enough, these are reach. These are not infantile hemangioma in the classic sense. And just like that lesion on the scalp went away, we almost always just recommend no treatment whatsoever. You don't have to remove these. You don't have to give drugs. In fact, the drugs won't work. Occasionally these babies will be in heart failure because they'll have a high output arteriovenous shunt in or around the tumor, but that's rarely necessary. What's interesting is when I started in pediatric surgery, these lesions were commonly transplanted. As I said, you know, these are frightening things when people see bad outcomes, and you take out a liver, put a new one in, and the tumor's gone. The only time in my career I have ever stood up at a national meeting and went to a microphone and made anything close to a critical remark was when a very large, at the time, transplant center presented their series of hepatic transplantation for liver hemangioma. And I sort of politely said, well, this is a beautiful series of doing a hepatic transplantation for a benign disease that goes away. Or you can make it go away faster with medications for those that respond to medications. And in fact, nobody would do a liver transplant for almost any of these going forward. That's probably where my contributions to medicine stopped. This is the next pattern, multifocal lesion. And here you can see two different examples. The one on the left's got kind of bigger tumors and bigger blood vessels. And the one on the right has a bunch of little marbles in there and smaller vessels. And the size of the vessels is important because these multifocal lesions can also sometimes present in heart failure. And that's where it gets confusing, because I just said the reach lesions, the focal ones, can have heart failure because of arteriovenous shunting. And now I'm showing an example where the same thing can happen with multifocal lesions. This is actually truly infantile hemangioma. microscopically, this is exactly the same lesion you see in the skin, this so-called strawberry lesion. And this will respond to propranolol. In fact, they will melt away with propranolol, which is how we treat them. The size of the blood vessels does not necessarily correlate to the size of the tumors. And here's an unfortunate example of this. This is a very old pathologic example. And this baby obviously had a very massive heart from high output shunting in the liver, but the tumors are quite small. Histologically, this is classic infantile hemangioma. The stain in the bottom right is a GLUT1 stain, which is a stain that is relatively specific for infantile hemangioma. Also present in brain and placenta and a couple other places, but is not present in the other lesion I showed you, that Riche lesion. So how do we treat these multifocal lesions? Well, these days we mostly observe them. We watch them with ultrasound. They're mostly found now because the dermatologists get an ultrasound because of the multifocal skin lesions. So we find them early. We can watch them. We have time to watch them. If they start growing or if they start having heart failure, we give them propranolol and they melt away. Only rarely, and almost never now, do we need to do shunt embolization because we find these quickly. This is a different story. Okay, these diffuse lesions are the ones, if there ever was a baby now who would die from a hepatic hemangioma, it would be this. And these babies die for the obvious reason. Somebody put a bowling ball in this baby's belly. These babies die of abdominal compartment syndrome. They cannot ventilate. They go into renal failure from compression of the renal veins. And it's a problem. And this exact baby is a baby we learned a lot from. So he was transferred to us from Akron, Ohio, in this state. And he was not, we really didn't have a chance. We tried everything. That scar in the belly is I did a fasciotomy. I opened the midline fascia of the abdomen to try and make more room for the abdominal compartment syndrome to be relieved. While we tried giving, and we gave every drug the oncologist could think of, even though this is a benign tumor, we attempted to go to the angio suite to intentionally infarct half the liver by embolization. We had by this point realized that this was not a baby in high output heart failure, and embolization wasn't likely to help in terms of heart failure. And so we went to angiography to try and literally kill half the liver to make space. And the anesthesiologist said, well, I want an echo first because liver hemangiomas cause heart failure. And we said, oh, no, we got this figured out now. This type, this diffuse type actually doesn't have these high flow shunts and there's not gonna be high output heart failure. You can just do the anesthesia. And they said, if you want anesthesia, you get an echo. So we got an echo. And the echo showed a big surprise. It showed heart failure, but it was not high output heart failure. It was low output heart failure. In fact, there was almost no contractility of the ventricle, which turned out to be from hypothyroidism. Now, this child did not have congenital hypothyroidism. This child had a thyroid gland. This child had acquired hypothyroidism. This is what the image looked like, and you can see why these babies have trouble ventilating and having renal function. It looks like cannonballs stacked together, and there's almost no normal parenchyma in between the tumors. So we went ahead and sort of did what we could, but the family ultimately chose, and this was a case that only would have survived with transplantation. The family was not interested, and they went back to Akron for terminal care. But in the meantime, I had cajoled our endocrinologists, and I had seen this several times. And one of the sort of bad things about being a big hospital like Boston Children's is I counted at the time, we had 28 endocrinologists. We have more now. And so every time you'd get an endocrine consult, you'd get a different person because they're in their lab and they come out, you know, 2 weeks a year. And I impugned them in the ICU. I said, this baby's going to die. We see this happen. Somebody needs to explain why these babies have hypothyroidism. And Stephen Wong, who's the first author in this paper, was the first year endocrine fellow. And he said, I believe you. I want to study this. I remember Brianna. Now, Brianna was a child 3 years earlier who was the last child who died with this exact same situation. I said, how do you know Brianna? And he said, I was an intern rotating through the ICU when you and Dr. Folkman came in on Christmas Day and withdrew support, and she died. And I want to figure this out. And fortunately, his pediatric endocrine mentors said to him, you're welcome to study it, but, you know, we're pediatric doctors. We don't know anything about the thyroid. The thyroid is in the, you know, we don't have thyroid disease. You either have a thyroid or you don't have a thyroid. Go next door to the Brigham and work with Reed Larson. And Reed Larson is an endocrinologist. And they worked together and they put together this is the kinetics on this exact baby. Now, the blue line is the important line. This is a log scale. So the TSH, when they started, was 216, normal being 0 to 5. So this is why this baby's heart was barely contractile. I, as a pediatric surgeon, knew nothing about hypothyroidism and didn't understand the impact of a TSH of 216 on brain development and how impaired this child would have been had he survived. But this graph is showing this, not too much detail. It took 9 times the amount of thyroid hormone to replace an adult without a thyroid to get this child euthyroid. And so what they demonstrated was this was a consumptive hypothyroidism. And they demonstrated the mechanism is that all hemangiomas have this overexpression of this type 3 iodothyronine deiodinase, which is an enzyme that cleaves iodine off of all thyroid hormones, whether it be endogenous or exogenous. So as much thyroid hormone as they were pumping into this baby, the tumor was so big, it was cleaving the iodine and inactivating it. And so it had to just keep pumping and pumping and pumping. This is actually the first infant ever to get intravenous thyroid replacement. And so Stephen became quite famous as a fellow. This was actually the first paper he ever wrote. He was a first author in the New England Journal. I told him it was all downhill from there. I mean, he became keynote speaker at endocrine meetings around the world. Not that anybody really cared in the endocrine world about hemangiomas, but it turns out this was the first and still the only human disease caused by abnormally rapid breakdown of a naturally occurring hormone, which took them a while to convince me of, but obviously they were correct. Very shortly thereafter, others saw this and started treating these babies. And basically the way they did is everybody called Stephen and he helped them with the kinetics. You have to give massive doses of thyroid replacement, but it's a perfect biomarker because as the tumor regresses in this day and age now with propranolol, you can watch the need for thyroid replacement to go down as the TSH is easier to regulate. Fortunately, we almost never see this condition anymore, right? We treat these when we see them with aggressive propranolol, might even add steroid, aggressive thyroid replacement. And if you catch one late, like we did here, you would get a transplant consultation to contemplate. But the reason we almost never see these anymore is because the dermatologists have identified these multifocal lesions before they proliferate and become diffuse. And so they don't get abdominal compartment syndrome. So Judith Folkman, you know, when we published this paper said, this is the first time a surgeon ever contributed to the prevention of cognitive impairment in children. But what really has happened is the dermatologists have now prevented not only the cognitive impairment, because we almost never see the aggressive hypothyroidism, but we also don't see these babies die. And the credit goes to Ilona Frieden and her colleagues around the world from whom they have learned from her. So we've debunked a bunch of myths about hepatic hemangiomas. We actually can predict which ones need to be treated, which ones can be watched, which ones need to be embolized and very rarely need to be transplanted. Propranolol turns out is a miracle. It's the only drug we use for these now. I spend most of my career trying to convince my colleagues not to operate on these. I learned that hypothyroidism is really bad. One of the great ironies is I was hypothyroid at the time that we initially did this study and did not understand the importance of it and didn't go back to my PCP. And Reed Larson wrote me a prescription right there when he heard that. And I take my little pill every morning. And almost none of these should be fatal. I'm gonna move on a little bit to some of what I do since I say not to operate on hepatic lesions. This is a syndrome called CLOVE syndrome, or now we would call this in the PIK3 related overgrowth syndrome. but we often call this CLOVE syndrome. Don't have time to go into what the acronym stands for. But as a surgeon, I have spent much of my career trying to help these children. It looks like something that a surgeon can help with, although it wasn't something that there was anybody to teach me how to do. So we kind of made this up as we went along. And you just kind of pick one anatomic area at a time. These bleed a lot. It takes a phenomenal anesthesia, blood bank, and nursing team to work with this. Dr. Nidigal had the opportunity to scrub on some of these with me. And basically, I don't take pictures during the bleeding, but I can promise you this was a bloody operation. Basically, all we do is open up. We've got too much skin. We open up the skin, take out the extra tissue, and treat it kind of like a birthday present with the too much wrapping paper, and we fold up the extra tissue, the extra skin, and there's the extra pieces, and we fold it up and put it back together however the child's anatomy deems will work. I can assure you I lost a lot of blood during this operation. It was a very gratifying result, and the family asked us to move on to other anatomic parts. So we moved on down to the pubic region. And again, these are all custom operations. There's no book to tell you where to make the incision or how to arrange things. And then we moved down from, and we'd done the torso, we'd done the genitalia, and now we moved on to the buttock and thigh. Same thing, we open up the birthday present to take out the present, have extra wrapping paper, put it back together, cut off the extra, and try and make a nice scar. Kind of simple, not rocket science, not necessarily simple to manage, but simple in concept. So here's the same child, and we've gone through these external debulking operations, and then we're looking at, and these children commonly have posterior mediastinal lesions as well. And you can see, these are some of her early films, where you can still see she has a lot of soft tissue mass on the chest wall. And this thing is enlarging, and they tend to do this even though they're malformations. These are active lesions. And so I looked at that chest x-ray and we decided, not worth going in there for that. The child's asymptomatic and, you know, a benign lesion in the mediastinum, not such a big deal. We'll leave it alone, but we watched it. And then it got to this. And now you got a, you know, 2.5-year-old child who's got basically no lung volume, no room for lung development. You can see the chest wall is already becoming malformed with the rib deformities. And you can see on the MR, this thing is really occupying most of the chest wall, chest cavity. So we scheduled this patient for a thoracotomy, and we're gonna go take it out. And the family lived up in Maine, and they came down, and I met with Bob in my office the day before and to describe the operation and to get consent. And I was describing it to her, and I was remembering how much bleeding I had from the first operation. And the way we stopped the bleeding is basically close the skin, put a drain on, and tamponades. And I was explaining to her, like, you can't do that in the chest cavity. And if I get into that kind of bleeding, I'm not going to be able to stop it. And I said, you know, I feel compelled to do this operation, but I'm afraid to do this operation. I have to tell you, I'm afraid to operate on your daughter. And I have to tell you that there's probably a 50% chance that she could bleed to death in the operating room. And as I'm saying that, she started crying, I started crying. And I said, I'm so sorry, I don't know what to do. I wish there were a pill. And so the surgeon wants when we don't have a good option mechanically. And I said, wait a minute. And we canceled the operation. And I called in one of my colleagues. Now, going back in history, earlier in my career, I had studied with Dr. Volpe and some of his colleagues whether we expect tumors to be angiogenic, right? So we looked at some of the vascular tumors and we can see that this is looking at angiogenic growth factors and matrix metalloproteinases, which allow for expansion of tumors. And we weren't surprised that tumors, the bigger ones, have more of these factors. But we also demonstrated that malformations, which we think of malformations as being stagnant, like it's embryologic, you didn't develop, an anus, so you have imperfect anus. And we thought of vascular malformations as being stagnant. But as I just showed in that x-ray, that lesion was expanding. And even though it's histologically benign, we started studying this and we saw here that, in fact, these are biologically active. And we had raised the question, when will there be a drug that we could use to treat these? And so Denise Adams who was in Cincinnati at the time and later joined us and now is in Philadelphia, had sort of make a little bit of a leap of faith with this baby, who had this horrible Kaposi form hemangioendothelioma, which is a benign tumor, but was going to be a fatal tumor. Had failed all of these aggressive therapies. And she talked to one of her nephrologists, and they treat tuberous sclerosis and angiomyolipomas with sirolimus. They'd started doing that, and the tuberous sclerosis genes are on the mTOR pathways, as we see here. And so she sort of took a leap of faith, and even though this baby had something that wasn't proven, didn't have a gene for it, the baby was going to die. And so she gave sirolimus. And had this kind of miraculous response. And as a result, then he started treating a whole bunch of different types of complex malformations with sirolimus, sort of see what would work. And here's some examples. And it turns out the lymphatic lesions tend to respond the best. And here's lymphatic malformation of the tongue. You can see this beautiful response. And here's something that we call generalized lymphatic anomaly. And you can see the bony lesions in the pelvis and the femurs really improving with sirolimus. Here's another one with lymphatic pleural effusions, and you can see the improvement in the effusion just with the medication. And so they published, and so finally, those of us mechanical people, the interventionalologists, the surgeons who kept saying we need a drug, finally we actually had medications, a medication for the treatment of a malformation, something I wish Dr. Folkman was around to have seen. So now we found there was value in all those pounds of tissue that I had been cutting off of people for decades. And molecular genetics had accelerated to the point where we knew we were dealing with somatic, mostly non-heritable mutations. And so Matt Warman, one of our molecular geneticists, took upon to figure out, could we find the somatic mosaic mutation for some of these lesions? And to do that, of course, you can't just draw blood and do a cheek swab because it's not a germline mutation. You can only get the mutation from the affected tissue. And we have lots of affected tissue. So we went back and we extracted DNA from our specimens, even in paraffin by this point, and then asked the patients to give us cheek swabs or blood draws, and we matched up the genomes, and we took patients with phenotypically similar lesions, and we did multiple patients and looked at their affected tissue and their germline DNA and matched them up, and we found enough patients that all had the same mutation, different in the affected tissue from the unaffected tissue. We then were able to do this sort of needle in a haystack analysis. And in these patients with Clove syndrome, which is what this little girl had with this lesion in the mediastinum, we had 31 patients, and they all had this mutation in PIK3CA. Now, that was kind of convenient because Denise had already been giving sirolimus, which is an mTOR inhibitor down here, for patients with all sorts of different lesions, although hadn't treated anybody with cloves. And Clove syndrome is up here in this mTOR pathway. So I call our smart hematologist oncologist and I introduced this family to them. And I said, I think we should try this. So we tried it. And here's that MRI that we started with, canceled the thoracotomy. And you can see over the course of under a year, a dramatic reduction in the size of this mass. This isn't cancer, right? You don't have to get it all out, but we were able to allow room for the lung to develop and to prevent the chest wall malformation. I still follow this young lady, she's never had a thoracotomy, and the lesion is significantly smaller than it was there. Really a miracle that's happened over time. This one is another one with a really weird name. We're stuck with this name. These are neither blue, rubber, blebs, nor nevi, but it's the name that we're stuck with. And when I started in this field, these patients present with GI bleeding. And I thought, well,
I'm a surgeon. I can cut that out. What's the big deal? We can stop the GI bleeding like a polyp. And people say, no, you can't do that. These keep coming back. They're like tumors, even though they're not. And I said, that doesn't make any sense. If it's a malformation, you're teaching these are malformations. If you cut it out, it should be gone. It's like saying that, if somebody has syndactyly and you divide their fingers, that their fingers are going to grow back together. No, you fixed it. And so I started cutting them out because these patients were bleeding and getting hundreds of blood transfusions. And it turns out it's very simple to do. It's not rocket science to cut these things out, simple general surgery techniques. And it works. Sometimes it takes a little longer than other ones. This is how we do it. We just open up the bowel and pluck out all these little mulberries, and you got to get them all because you don't know which ones are bleeding. And sometimes it takes a little longer. This woman had 544. I know that because we keep little tick marks on the whiteboard in the OR to keep us sane over the 20 or 30 hours it takes to do this. But they don't lose blood. It's not a difficult operation. But sometimes you have this. And this little boy demonstrates what I always wondered. Most of these babies, or at least more than half of them, have what I call the mama lesion. And this young boy obviously has a mama on his butt. And lots of these little baby lesions. Like everything we learned in medical school, so well, that's like a primary and metastases. You have a primary breast cancer and you have multiple metastases that are smaller. It looks like this. And the patients that are in the 30s, 40s, 50s tell us they keep getting new ones. And we were explaining that away by saying, oh, they're actually not new. They're malformations. So they had to be there embryologically. They were there before birth and they just expanded over time. And venous malformations do expand over time. And these are venous malformations. That never really sat well with me. When I did operate in this child's bottom, and it's still gives me angina to think back about how dangerous that operation was, and he did beautifully. But we really had a biologic phenomenon we needed to explain. And I had been sort of badgering my smart genetic colleagues to figure this out. It's not a common disease, but it's a very curious disease. And this is a paper led by colleagues of ours in Brussels, Laurence Boone and Mika Vakula, and they have found the mutations for many of the vascular malformations. And this one was something that I impugned them for over a decade. And finally, Laurence flew back to Boston, where they actually met in our center and fell in love and got married and moved back to Europe and started their own center. Another sort of interesting story of how things happen in medicine. And the Ti2 mutation had already been identified in a germline fashion, a double hit, but a germline fashion back in the 90s. And this rare type of hereditary venous malformation, this VMCM, was caused by a Ti2 mutation. In fact, they were fellows on that paper. That's how they met. And I wish I had time to go through the genetics. And this one this one chart taught me a lot about genetics. And Mika had explained to me about 10 times how this works. But the fascinating thing about this sort of blue rubber glove nevus syndrome is this is a unique situation in which this condition is caused by not only two hits, but it's two hits on the same allele. And they're both somatic. And that's why condition is so rare. But the other thing that they proved is that they are clonal. So now we have a benign condition, a non-malignant condition that we have proved is clonal. And in fact, it is, as I had suggested them two decades earlier, this is metastases. This is just like a cancer with a primary and cells are circulating. We now know, of course, that endothelial cells can circulate. So this is an example, one of the very few examples in medicine of benign metastases. So such a fascinating condition. So just seems curious, except now we have treatment, right? And so the blue rubber glove nevus syndrome is up here at the top of this circle of vascular anomalies, we call it, the Ti2 mutation. And we already have now the mTOR inhibitor of sirolimus. And so some of these patients that I was operating on, somebody said, well, why don't we just see if they respond to sirolimus and maybe they'll stop bleeding. And here's an example of a patient all the asterisks on here are blood transfusions. And so this this child over the course of just 1 year had gotten a lot of transfusions to keep a hemoglobin in the sort of, you know, 6 to 10 range. Sirolimus was started just before January, transfusion stopped, right? So here again, put myself out of business. As a surgeon, I used to operate a lot of stuff that these medications work on. We still operate this occasionally, and these patients do break through. But it really is a miracle that you could give a medication to treat a malformation that is bleeding the intestine, and it works. Now I'm going to move on to another one. We have all these sort of strange names of our conditions because they were named descriptively, you know, back 100 years ago. This one was described in France in the 40s, and this is Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome. And it's what we would call a combined capillary lymphatical venous malformation with overgrowth. It's probably the most common condition I treat. And this is what I do. These patients have heavy legs and don't fit in their clothing and ask for these operations. And I call this a fillet of fish operation. This one, I have a tourniquet on, so it's not bleeding so much. I make an incision. It's not very different than that cloves operation. Take out the extra stuff, cut off the extra wrapping paper and put it back together. And this is a commonplace operation that I've done throughout my career, and you have generally a happy patient. But lots of these patients have this, and you can see on the lateral aspect of his leg, this huge primitive embryonic vein. I call it the vena cervella. It was described by a vascular surgeon in France. It was dogma when I started in this that you cannot interrupt this vein, you cannot remove this vein, you cannot debulk the tissue that has this vein because they don't have a normal deep system, or if they don't have a normal deep venous system, that you will cause phlegmatious cerebral dolage. You obstruct venous outflow to their leg and they'll end up with an amputation. And so in the beginning part of my career, I would sort of map these out and see these big veins and I would debulk around them. And here you can see, I like marked it out with ultrasound and I took stuff off, make sure it'll hurt the vein, make sure it hurt the vein. And then this family showed up. Now this is a little girl who was adopted from China. Her parents were in Texas. Her father is an ENT surgeon. Their children had grown, gone away to college. They wanted more children. They adopted this little girl and her sister from an orphanage in China. And they came to me and I said, you know, the imaging shows no normal deep venous system. And it could be really dangerous if we debulk all this tissue. And he said, listen, there's these surgeons who want to operate on the foot to get her into a shoe. And I don't want to put her through three operations on her foot to get her into a shoe, only to have her become a teenager and say, I want you to debulk my buttock and my thigh, end up with an amputation, and now lose the foot that we just put all that effort into repairing. He said, Dr. Fishman, what is the evidence that you really can't debulk this? I said, well, you know, I've had my suspicions about that all along, but it's kind of a dangerous thing to sort of, there's no way to prove it. He said, well, I'm a surgeon, you're a surgeon. We're gonna each take a week to search the world's literature. And if you can't find any evidence that this is not gonna work, I want you to debulk my daughter. And I will not hold her responsible. I'd rather have her lose her leg now and grow up as an amputee than as a teenager to have to go through that trauma. You know, what better patient could you have than an informed, loving family like that? And so he convinced me. We learned from the patients. We developed our confidence from the families. And so we did this and we decided to do pretty aggressive debulking so as not to put it through three operations and then lose her leg. And you can see this, you know, enormous primitive vein and here it is in the side here and all this extra tissue we want to take out. So we did this, you know, wrapping paper operation and took out all the stuff for her buttock and her thigh, had the extra pieces and put it back together. And she had a, you know, reasonable, you know, they were happy with her, you know, her contour and her outcome. She didn't even get a wound infection, let alone lose her leg or get phlegmatous cerebral dolens. And so this family gave us the courage to do what I thought was right, but it was kind of hard to experiment on somebody. And so we learned from the families. And I thank this family because many, many, many patients thereafter have been able to have this type of an operation. And it turns out if you do diversion venography, so here we see the large vein, if you put a tourniquet on or if you obliterate the vein with now, which we do routinely with sclerotherapy, embolization, endovenous laser, the kitchen sink, whatever works, the deep venous system is almost always there and it matures just by forcing the blood into it. This became really important because we had also noticed over the years, and it took a long time to convince some of my colleagues in Europe that this is true, but these patients develop pulmonary emboli. And we had to go around and show people our deaths, our complications, to prove to people this was important. Because those big veins are the conduit directly to the central circulation. This is a patient with the upper extremity. This is cloves. And this massive primitive vein, you know, no surprise that this stuff, you'd have clot form in here, and if it broke off, you know, that clot's going to be way too big to be able to expect the child to survive an embolus like that. And so this is what we do. And we identify these children at birth or in infancy, as soon as we know about them. We look for these veins, we coil these veins, we do endovenous laser. It's usually an outpatient procedure, very simple. And we prevent the conduit from allowing clots to form and travel to the lung. And we, again, this is something I don't do. I used to remove these veins. Our interventional radiologists do this routinely. Here's another patient who taught me something. This woman was 38 when she came to me. And I realized that speaking to neonatologists and to pediatricians, but she had this from birth. This is a malformation, this is congenital. And all the doctors in her life had said, go away. I don't know what that is, I'm afraid of that, go away. And it's easy as a physician to say, go away. It's not your problem anymore, you go on to your next patient. She lived 38 years with this. And she ended up coming to us from Arizona. She sent us a photo and I said, oh yeah, that's easy. We do this all the time. And this was literally a 45 minute operation with no transfusions and is an outpatient procedure. It's just because we see it, right? But we didn't always know what it was. We weren't willing to leave patients like this. And so this is simple. And she went on to, you know, have children. She actually was a social worker. And helped our social work at our vascular center understand what it was like to grow up through teenage years with something like this. And then through the emotional sort of swing of, oh my God, this could have been removed when I was four, which we now do routinely. So that was a simple one. Well, this one looks more simple. This is a little kid, right? Not as big, not as dramatic, except she came to us because of vaginal bleeding. And you can see that the hymen is quite infiltrated with abnormal venous tissue, and she was sort of bleeding from that, which is not normal at this age. And if you look at the CT scan, the scan, it looks like just a little bit of tissue in the labia, no big deal. But if you look up higher, she has the entire pelvis, the rectum is surrounded by venous malformation. And if you see this big, huge pipe here, this is the inferior mesenteric vein that drains the hindgut and takes blood back to the liver, where all the gut goes. And here's an example of what happens in these patients. It took five of these before we noticed it. And this is an angiogram showing blood contrast being injected into the superior mesenteric artery through the aorta. And the blood is supposed to go down the arteries and up the veins and back to the liver. And here's portal up here, and we should be seeing the portal vein fill, which it is, but we're also seeing the blood go backwards down this huge vein, just like varicose veins or varicocele. The mesenteric vein is flowing backwards, and that means there's stagnant blood. And what happens in this big pipeline is the blood clots, just like in that venous cerveau in the leg or the big vein, it clots and it embolizes. And in the visceral system, that's this. Portal vein thrombosis, lifelong portal hypertension. Some of these patients going to need liver or bowel transplantation. It is a horrible, horrible problem. Now that we see the pattern, we watch the patients, we look for this. Every baby we see with a genital stain of any kind, we just get an ultrasound. If the vein's big, you can predict this. We put them on anticoagulation immediately, and then you can operate. For the surgeons in the room, this is the pancreas. This is that big inferior mesenteric vein, and it is quite simple to just ligate that vein, not much different than you'd ligate a varicocele or varicose veins, and you can prevent this propagation of thrombus. Kyle, you neonatologists see Kyle all the time in the abdomen, in the chest, sometimes in the pericardium. It can reflux any place. Here's an example of Kyle reflux in the pelvis, leaking out the scrotum. Here's a case of Kyle's ascites. This child had had multiple operations in South America, obviously emaciated, nutritionally debilitated, had failed ability to find the leak. We started, this is way back when, doing old-fashioned lymphangiograms, cut down on the groin, trying to get a needle into a lymphatic, inject some contrast. In this case, we did a CAT scan and we saw the cisternic chyle flowing backwards towards the renal hilum. We ended up feeding a bunch of cream, operating, and finding the leak, problem solved. I'm looking at the clock and I'm gonna move along here. What my theory of how Kyle reflux works is that you have lymphatics, you have thoracic duct, the lumen is there, but it doesn't propel forward. And as a pediatric surgeon, that reminded me of Hirschsprung's disease. You see babies in the NICU all the time. They have a rectum, they have an anus, but they're constipated and they can't defecate. It's because they don't have normal neural function, muscular function of the distal rectum. And I hypothesized that was the case in the thoracic duct. It's just harder to measure because it's a much smaller lesion. Esophageal achalasia, same thing. Primary obstructive megaureter, same thing. So we started doing lymphangiograms, which back then was hard. And this child was the one who proved it to me. It was surreptitious. The family asked us to do an endoscopy at the same time because he had some GI symptoms. At the end of lymphangiogram, our GI guy came in and did an endoscopy. And the reason this shows so poorly is because this is the green dye that we inject in the groin to do the cut down lymphangiogram 12 hours earlier. And he looked into duodenum and all he saw was this green dye. And so it was injected in the skin of the groin, went up the lymphatics of the retroperitoneum and refluxed into the mesenteric and duodenal lymphatics. And this was finally proof to me that reflux was a real thing in lymphatics. And here's the dye in his gut to prove it. So I said, well, if we can do an operation to sort of fix Hirschsprung's disease, maybe we can fix the thoracic duct. And so I convinced some of our microsurgeons to do this. And here's an example. We give a bunch of cream, cut down in the neck, find the thoracic duct, it reimplanted into a vein, and it works. This is some animal experimentation we did to develop a new lymphangiogram dye for MR so we wouldn't have to use cut downs. Now it turns out that's quite easy to do. This is a child who had massive chylopericardium. The lymphangiogram shows this Hirschsprung's-like thoracic duct reflux into the pericardium. We did this reimplantation and his pericardium dried up permanently. Here's a teenager who in high school had to go between every single class to the bathroom because she had vaginal chyle reflux. She would fill up several maxi pads every hour. And we did this operation and took almost a year for it to dry up, but she eventually has completely been relieved of her vaginal chyle reflux. So we learn from the patients. And the way we learn is by collaborating with each other, ask the smart person down the hall, ask the smart person across the country, work with the smart people across the ocean. It's all about collaboration. And it's really been such an honor to work in this field and to add a little tiny piece of my own stamp to it by hanging with all these smart people. This is our group here in Boston. And it is really such an honor to join you and to speak as a surgeon to a group of pediatricians and neonatologists. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Fishman. I always enjoy the storytelling aspects of your presentations. I have one question while others are going to submit through the Q&A. And this is a really 30,000 foot question, especially given, I guess, my interest in development. Are there organs or tissues that are protected from developing vascular anomalies? Or even I would go as far to say, are there animal species that are protected from developing these vascular anomalies? And if so, why do you think that is?
Wow, that's a great question. You know, there are organ systems that get different vascular malformation. So for example, AVMs in the brain,
right, which are quite common in the central nervous system, are very different from AVMs in the non-neural tissues and in extracranial tissues, and they have different mutations. But I don't think I can think of an organ system that doesn't develop some type of vascular malformation. I'm not sure I've seen them in the fingernails or the hair, but other than that, the eyes are quite rare. Obviously, they're malignant vascular tumors in the eye. In terms of animals, I'm not a veterinarian, but there's only a few examples of animals that we have. We wish we had animal models of naturally occurring vascular malformations. I suspect that they exist, but they're just too uncommon for us to have predictable models. There are some that we know of, and we wish we create animal models. I see Dr. Sun put that question in the chat as to whether animal models. We have created some animal models. Others have done so in vitro as well. Now that we have mutations, so for example, we can create a cloves, a PIK3CA, a zebrafish. We can create a mouse in utero. There are mostly lethal mutations because we're the timing of when you create a mutation. And we're hoping to be able to do rescue operations, not rescue operations, rescue medications to have an environment where we can sort of test additional therapies.
Thank you for that. And I guess as a separate question, you know, this morning I feel like we've spent the morning with a very broad view of not just all of the anomalies that you and others have helped characterize and see, but also the treatments for them. And at least for someone who doesn't think about vascular anomalies all the time, it seems like we've made a lot of progress in the last, 10, 20 years. But what do you think are the bottlenecks moving forward, if any?
Well, first of all, I'm disappointed having trained with us in Boston that you don't think about vascular malformations all the time, Omar. But yes, it has been quite a dramatic ride to see the transformation in our understanding and therapy. I entered a field, I was lucky, right? I entered a field that was devoid of most knowledge. And so we viewed ourselves sort of being back in varicose time, still describing things by what they look like. But we were able to apply 21st century science to understand these lesions. And as you pointed out in your talk, to apply modern medications, often oncologic or immunologic medications to these malformations and tumors, it's been incredibly gratifying. We are nowhere near done. Arteriovenous malformations are the holy grail. Any surgeon or interventionalist who says they can cure an arteriovenous malformation is inexperienced. I mean, unless you can amputate. The biology is just well beyond our understanding. We still don't understand. We have the mutations for almost all these vascular malformations. We still don't understand what causes hemangioma. We understand that there are, angioblasts, but we don't understand why and what the drivers are, why they involute. We still have so much to learn.
So I want to, just in recognition of the time, I want to thank again Dr. Fishman for some incredible stories and for teaching us what patients can teach us. I think it's the type of thing that as clinicians we always need to remind ourselves, but also for illustrating kind of that connection between science and clinical care that goes back and forth and that we, again, just need to remind ourselves of. Thank you also to Dr. Nijigal for moderating this session. And thank you to everyone for attending. For those of you who are part of our Tooley seminar, ongoing talks in the afternoon, you can log on to that session in just a few minutes. So thank you, everybody, and have a good week.
Thank you so much for the opportunity.